फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल अगेन। दिस इज़ विनियोगी फ्रॉम क्राइस्टचर्च, योर फ्रेंड इन न्यूजीलैंड। सो आई एम गोइंग टू टेक यू ए न्यू टूर टू माय सिटी क्राइस्टचर्च। सो कम अलोंग विद मी। So today we are going to discuss about various options for migration, and I'm going to tell you one by one for each country. So stay along with me. Let's go in the car. Let me set up the camera first so that we can talk to each other. Yeah, this is all good to go now. This will be better, I think. Yeah. Yeah. So, oh my God, I just forgot my notes. You just hold for a second and I'll get back to you. Yes, I'm here again. Sorry, you guys, to keep you on hold. Yeah, but we need to take everything with us. So, because otherwise, if I forgot my notes, so you can imagine, you will only get the half of the information. Yeah. So let's go. Let me back my vehicle. So today video, we are going to first discuss about a new visa in UK. So this is a new visa, as I told you before, which UK government just introduced in the last month. So I'm going to tell you what is the eligibilities, how we are going to start up the process, and when this visa is going to be open for everyone. So this let's start discuss about, first of all, who are the eligible candidates. So this is a new startup visa, which we also call UK scale-up visa, for high-skilled workers. So high-skilled workers means the person who is having a innovative qualification, or who is having a very, very highly recognized qualification with them. So that is the education background what they are expecting it. So this UK scale-up visa is who is a graduate or a postgraduate having a bachelor degree, they are eligible for this visa. The salary cap about this visa for all the eligible candidates is 33,000 euros. 33,000 pounds, not euros. So one has having a graduation degree along with a job offer, which is the primary requirement of this visa. So be ensure you are having a job offer from UK scale-up companies. So now you will ask me what is that UK scale-up companies. We will also cover up this topic in this video, so you have to stay along with me. My camera is little fluctuating, so you can see that while driving. So this visa, as I told you, was launched in last month, in the month of October, and this is open for all the applicants who are first of all passing through a language test. So when we talking about the language test, we are talking about the IELTS examination. So you have to be ensure that you have to be a desired IELTS band in the English exam. So when you have to pass the IELTS examination with a required band, and then you have to be eligible for this visa. There are other visas which doesn't have an IELTS requirement, but for if you want to apply for this specific visa, you have to ensure that you pass the IELTS examination. That is a mandatory requirement, and the IELTS score is also where they are demanding very high. So one has to be score more than 7 band in each modules, so which is a very, very, very high English language requirement. So this is not for the person who cannot crack the IELTS examination. So definitely this visa is absolutely not for those people. So second thing, as I briefed you, one have to get a job offer from UK only the scale-up companies, 33,000 pound annual package. So, and when we talking about this 33,000 pound as an annual package, it doesn't include your perks. So that means they are only talking about your gross salary before the tax. So tax can be deducted after this gross salary. That's what I want to say. So your package should be more than 33,000 pound. So when we come back to this 33,000 pounds, so you have to be always remember that 33,000 pound salary is not a pretty very small amount to get this kind of job offer. It is a very, very, very high skill salary. So which means you not only have a desired high level qualification, but your salary should be also very, very competitive, and it should be matched with the this scale of visa standards. If you talk about the average salary in UK, the minimum salary, so which is roughly around I think 20 or 21,000 pound annual package without perks. So that is approximately minimum salary which one usually getting when he works in UK. So why I'm telling you about this minimum wages, because you have to link it together. So that whenever you go and visit, like, you know, work in outside the country, so they gives you a minimum basic salary, but to get a, like, you know, a high salary, like, you know, is very, very a tough job. So you have to mentally prepare that. Yeah, of course, like, you know, I'm not saying, like, you know, if you have a desired qualification, of course you will get an offer, but it's not always been necessary. There are many graduates who are, like, you know, MBA or, like, you know, engineering degree holder, but even if you talk about in India, so probably they didn't get, like, you know, even like 20,000 minimum salary in their home country. So same thing applies in the other countries as well. So to get a, like, high salaries jobs, one has to be very experienced, and one has to be, like, you know, with desire their unique qualification. That's what I want to brief you up in this video. So now, coming back to the next question, what is a scale-up company and who can eligible for this scale-up company's process? So the company who is been in registered in UK, and if their annual revenue or the employment growth over the past 3 years should be more than 20%, that company can be eligible for a registration to, you know, start up their registration for this scale up process. Another point is, they have also a minimum employed persons, which is like 10 employees at the start of 3 years period. So for example, if someone want to register in today, like, let's say this is November 2021, so someone want to register their company for the scale up visa process in this month, so that means in 2018 October month, that employer must be carries like 10 employees minimum to be eligible for this registration process. And secondly, between 2018 to 2021, this entire period of 3 months, or sorry, 3 years, they have to show their annual revenue growth more than 20%, or the employment growth over like 20%. So for example, if he start up a company, like, you know, say with 20 employees, and every year if he is in, like, you know, recruiting more than 4 employees every year, so that means, like, you know, that company is being eligible for this scale up visa process. Now I am stopping my YouTube in between, because now we are, like, earlier I was driving in a quiet road, but now we are coming on the national highway, so probably I don't want to take a, like, you know, health and safety risk. So I'm just stopping this video in middle, and once I will, you know, reach the destination, then we will again talk together. Yeah, so we are going to reach our destination within 1 minute, and we are going to Holwell's Quarry Park. Yeah, let's see. Yeah, we can go inside. Yeah, there is a proper parking inside the car. Maybe we are lucky enough to get a parking there, otherwise we have to come back again on the main entrance, then we have to park outside on the off-street parking. This park I have come before as well, like 2-3 times. I really like the surroundings with this park. No, we can't park here. We can't park here. Oh yeah, we are lucky enough. Yes, yes, yes. We can park here. So So guys, this is, we also call this park as Crocodile Park. And here you go. Most of the time I make my videos in my home or maybe in the car, but I get like 2-3 calls this time from my followers, and they said, oh, why don't you make your video outside so that you can, they can also explore New Zealand and how the country looks like, what is the surroundings, where I'm living. So they want to see our country where I'm been based at. So let's finish this, like, you know, some topic which we covered. So we were discussing about UK scale up visa, which is going to be launched in next year, somewhere around like middle of 2022. But they already make the, like, you know, outlines how they are going to launch this visa in last month, as I told you before. As of now, you guys are wondering, like, you know, how much is the job opportunity, what is the, like, you know, market size, and how they are going to find out a job. Is it like difficult, or is can be easy, or it can be moderate? So let me tell you, as of like 2020, I mean in last year, I just go and some do a Google research, how many companies are been currently registered as their scale-up visa. So as of now, this figure says 36,510 in last year. So which is having an increase of like 3.7% over the past year. So that means the annual growth rate is increasing when we talk about the number of companies joining for this scale-up visa process. That means if you're talking about like 33,000 figures, roughly 36,510, I'm taking just roughly 36,000, it's a very huge quantity. So you can imagine, like, you know, there are so many companies where you can get the sponsorship easily if you are a high-skilled education qualification background. So but you have to dig more information if you want, like, you know, where we can find out this current companies list. So I will send you the link in the descriptions, and you can have a, like, you know, visit that website, and you will get the all the details there. So this is all about UK scale up visa. Then next we are going to discuss about our UK youth mobility visa. Let me come outside, otherwise whole video will be, you know, lying here only. Just give me a second. So we are coming back to the main topic, which was UK youth mobility visa. So what is this visa is all about? I have made a separate video specifically on this topic. So if you want to know more about this youth mobility visa, so you, I will provide the description in the link below, and you can go and visit there. So just, this is the park is all about. Crocodile Park I'm talking about. This is very beautiful. So about this youth mobility visa, the person who was eligible is a bachelor degree. So one has to be carry a bachelor degree from his home country. There is no specific IELTS requirement for this youth mobility visa. You can also, if you are not like qualified, you can also come through experience category. So minimum requirement experience is 3 years. For this category visa, no sponsorship has been required. And remember guys, this is not like, you know, currently this visa is active, but for specifically Indians, this visa they cannot apply. So this visa is going to like include
to Indians in coming January month. That's what they told in the immigration website. Yeah. I just saw a small dog here, so this is a dog park as well. Yeah, I've been scared. But like, you know, coming back to, if dog bites you and if someone claimed that, so the dog owner has to pay $15,000 a fine if dog bites, and like, you know, or if he barks, or like, you know, he make people scary. Yeah. So this visa was launched in like 3-4 months before, youth mobility visa, and currently this youth mobility visa, we also called this like working holidays visa. So this is there are like some country tie-ups where the citizen of those country like Ireland, Japan, Korea, New Zealand, Australia, they are already being part of this youth mobility visa, so they can apply right now. But if you're talking about like specifically any Indian community, so they are not eligible right now. But UK government already declared that they are going to include Indians this year. So can you see that behind? You want to go to that mountain, so we can go that side. Yeah, this side. Yeah, that side. Yeah, so we are going right in somewhere on those trees right now. I will take you there. Yeah, come along with me. So from January onwards, they will include Indians as well in this list. So then, and the cap for this visa is 3,000 applicants from India only. I will not talk about like, you know, the other countries, because that's not so relevant. But if you know about like, if you want to know about what is the country-wise sponsorship numbers available, so you can go and visit that specifically my video available on my channel, then you can find all the details there. Otherwise, like, you know, we want to cover like, you know, in this video many other things actually. So next, coming back to the next visa, why I'm telling you about like these different visas, because constantly in the last week I received around like 8 to 9 calls where the people are asking like, can you give us some options where like we can't have a job sponsorship, but probably we would like to visit those countries and we would like to work there without sponsorship offer. So we're coming to this side. This is so beautiful. This is a dog park, so you can see this is a track, and in the middle side this is a long grass. It is up to like, you know, your knees high. I will take you there as well. And there is a roundabout. So this is a like circular shape, that side. I will take you there. Then from that side we can go up there, because can you see that like those small patch, like white color patch, this one. I will go and take you there, because last time I came there are like small sheep there. Yeah, the people are going there. Yeah. So why I was sharing about these different visa credits, so people are wondering, because to getting a job sponsorship from the home country, it is almost impossible, or it's very very difficult. But still, like, you know, the person is highly qualified, so he can always take a chance, and he is might be lucky there. So this video is specifically like 3-4 visa categories where people can apply without job sponsorship. So that's which we are going to discuss. And also I will cover like, you know, my other topics as well, which most of my followers are very curious to know about, that they want to know my lifestyle, where I'm living, what is this my country is all about, and we are going to discuss many things. Yeah, step by step. So this video is going to be very, very long. So if you really want to enjoy this video, just stay with me. So we will gain some knowledge as well about the different visa categories. We will also have our lifestyle. You can also communicate me through the comment section, and I will share you my number as well, the people who want to speak me directly. But for generic topics, please don't give me direct calls. I really hate that. If you can discuss here in the comment section, probably, like, you know, where everyone can see the comments, so probably that would be a best way to chat, because some might have, like, you know, the same questions and answers, so which you guys have having. So that's why I insist people, they should comment in the comment section, so everyone can know about it.
Hey baby, how are you? Hello. Come on.
So the small dog was, like, you know, playing around. Yeah, dogs are very friendly here. Can you see that? Yeah, with the small family. That was a cute dog, because this is a dog park. Yeah. So I was telling you that this grass is very long, very deep, you know. I will show you how this grass is high. Can you see that? It coming up to my knees. If I show you the posture, maybe from back side, I just put it into the grass, like that. And let's pick it up. So just see how big the grass is. So you can see now this is the depth of this grass. So next visa was a visa from Germany, which we also call job seeker visa. I also make a special video on job seeker visa. So this visa is for all those person who doesn't need a job offer, but they can come and visit the country and to find out a job. So this job, as itself, like, you know, the name itself suggests, job seeker visa. So you can find out a job there. Once you find out an employer there, and if he's ready to sponsor you, so probably you can switch over to the work visa, there, skill category visa in Germany. And later, after, like, you know, staying there like for 2 or 3 years, you can apply for permanent residency there. Germany job seeker visa is, again, the validity of this visa is for 6 months. So country gives you a chance for 6 months, and this is a one-time opportunity. You cannot apply again for this visa. Once you get selected or rejected, you cannot apply twice. So this is a lifetime opportunity. So everyone who is having a graduate degree can apply for this Germany job seeker visa. I will show you from here where we are going to go. We are going right up to there, this area. Yeah, on the top. So there is a walkway there, and we also want to go to that patch. And can you see this side? This grass is very beautiful. Yeah, this grass is very beautiful, very spongy. Yeah, I love this park. Actually, this is a small mountain, and we can have a, like, you know, a beautiful view of around the city. Yeah, Germany's job seeker visa is eligibility criteria is, one has to be a bachelor degree, and he must be 18 years old. He can stay there like for 6 months. For this visa, you required a funds, actually, funds in the bank. So the immigration officer might will ask you about the funds. So how you are going to sponsor yourself when you will be inside Germany? Because ultimately, Germany doesn't want, like, you know, the liability of the people. So you have to be insured, fully insured, before you leave your home country. So the insurance required like 30,000 euros to be eligible for this job seeker visa. You have to show through your bank statement, through your sponsorship from your parents, that they have sufficient funds to make you stay there for 6 months. So if you talk about how much of the living expense in Germany, roughly like 200 to 300 euros a month. So that will make you around, like, you know, the accommodation part, 30 to 40 euros per day is the living expense, which accounts towards the food and miscellaneous expenses. Yeah, Germany is not very costly. Yeah. So this is about, like, you know, different visa categories. So let me fold my paper, because I can't handle like too much stuff at a time. Otherwise, this would be too much for you. Too much for me, sorry. Yeah. So now the next question which my followers were asking me, should we go that side or maybe this side? Yeah. Yeah. You can also take from the background loop how it looks like. So let me show you. Welcome to the Gansu Garden. So you can read it. Gansu is famous for 8,000 years of yellow river culture and 3,000 years of Silk Road culture. The ancient Silk Road traverses the province of 1,600 kilometers according to the one quarter is local. So this is a description all about this park. So you can see. Yeah, this is precious city council. Yeah. So some of the followers, they asked me which country I would suggest to go and migrate there. This was a very funny question to me, actually. I find it very funny, actually. I don't know why they asked my suggestion for that, because it's again coming back to it's your area. Actually, I cannot make decision on my followers' behalf. For me, I've been traveling to around like 30 countries. Every country is beautiful. Every country has its own plus and minus constraints. So if you're asking my suggestion, of course, I will tell you from my perspective side only. My circumstances are different, your circumstances are different. So I recommend every individual, whoever asking me this question, which country they should be migrate. So can you see? Now we are on this patch. And how this park is look like. It's a very small steep, but I will show you where we come from. Can you see these guys there? We were there where I show you the picture of that mountain. Now we are here. It's just like, you know, 5 minutes walk and we are on the top of the hills. See my trouser, the green color? Yeah, it's so beautiful. Yeah. Yeah. So coming back to the question, which country is easy to migrate, or which country is the best to earn salary yeah, everyone want to ask about this question. So the answer is pretty very simple. I don't want to be make it complicated. See, this is the patch and this is the background of this beautiful mountain. Yeah, so the answer is very simple. If every country is beautiful, every country is safe. Every country has a quality life. You go anywhere outside your home country, it's beautiful everywhere. If you want to go to the English speaking countries, probably you have to pass through a IELTS examination, which is we call the English proficiency examination. Sometime, you know, it's become very dark because of the sunlight. It's very cloudy today. It's little drizzling, but I like to walk in drizzling. So, if you want to go to English speaking country, you have to pass through a IELTS test or a TOEFL test or a PT examination. So that means you have to prove your English proficiency abilities. Those houses, can you see that? Yeah, people are living there. This whole area is about Hallswell, this entire area. Yeah, this is not you can see this is a sliding landslide. No, this is not a landsliding, this is natural. Yeah, there is no vegetation or no grass there, so it's just like deep slope. Yeah, so like those stones, little like soil that's coming down to the valley actually. Yeah, we can also go there, but I think we have to go from that side. It will take very long time. My car hasn't parked near to that location. Or this one. This side actually. This grass. Yeah. So I was telling you about, like, you know, if you go to the English speaking countries, so English speaking countries are USA, Canada, UK, New Zealand, Australia, Ireland and Denmark. These are the countries where English is their first language. So if you want to go and migrate there at any point of time, if they don't ask you initially for work visa, most of the country doesn't want that IELTS certificate except USA or Canada. But if you go about like, or even Australia also want, like, you know, IELTS certificate for work visa. New Zealand doesn't want work visa for IELTS requirement. Yeah. So if you want to go to English speaking country, probably you must have a English proficiency somehow, not at initially state, but later on they will definitely ask you about the English proficiency exam. Yeah, and you have to pass with a desired band. All the English speaking country doesn't allow you less than 6.5 band. That's pretty very simple, straightforward. I don't want to give you a green picture. There are people, like, you know, who are not qualified enough, whose English abilities are very low actually. They can come for the work visa, but definitely they cannot apply the PR or residency until they didn't come to meet a 6.5 band expectations from these countries. Yeah, that is pretty very straightforward. Yeah, so don't bring yourself, like, and don't treat yourself in dark. Yeah, that's pretty very rude, but very very straightforward. Yeah, but there are many other beautiful countries somewhere in Europe and in Southern America where no one will ask you about the English proficiency, and you can go and settle there. And if you're talking about the wages how much you will earn, probably, like, you know, all countries wages are pretty awesome. So for example, if someone gives you a wage of the cheapest country or in terms of wages wise in Europe, gives you a minimum wage of like 700 euros, yeah, I'm talking about the Schengen area. But if you're talking about the Europe, there are many countries who gives you a minimum wage of like 500 euros. So let's take, like, you know, this 500 euros somewhere in Europe countries like Cyprus, Belarus, or these kind of small countries where the minimum wages are not so attractive. So, but coming back to, like, you know, even the person who is getting like 500 euros a monthly salary, how is going to maintain his expenses? So my answer would be, if a country gives you like 500 euros monthly salary, the expense, like living standard, living cost will also be very low. So in the country, like those countries where the minimum wages are like 500 euros monthly, the expense are roughly around, like, you know, 100 euros or maximum 100 and 150 euros. Let me sit here for a few minutes. Yeah, so the roughly overall expenses would be between like 100 to 150 euros monthly. So that means, like, you know, still you can have, like, you know, some savings in your hand as a bachelor. But of course, if you have a family and if you both working together, so the earnings would be 500 plus 500. I'm only talking about the minimum wages. So that means you will monthly earn around like 1000 euros, husband and wife. So 1000 euros, but your living expenses won't be double. You know why I'm saying this? Because when you live one in his one room, even if you are, like, you know, going to have your family, so you don't, your monthly rent won't going to increase. It, you shouldn't take it like double. So in the same room you can accommodate. The same way, like, you know, if a brother and sister is coming, so they can also maintain their expenses. As I also briefed you in my previous videos, like, you know, you can enjoy the, like, you know, pretty luxurious features in this country, like, you know, say 200 euros or $200 a single accommodation, one room set. But in the same room, if you're living like four persons, so that will divide your cost, like, you know, in between like four people. So four people, say, like, say for example, like $200 or 200 euros, so it will comes, like, you know, per person comes cost would be around like 50 euros or $50. That's it. That's how you're going to calculate your living expenses. This math is very simple, actually. So my hairs become very long. Yes, I love them. Yeah, don't put unnecessarily your observation and comments, like, you know, oh, this looks, doesn't like, I don't like those kind of, it's my personal issues. Don't give me your, like, you know, your own comments, your own thought process. Yeah. So someday I would like to have some dreadlocks in my hairs. I'm just want to grow them. This is up to, can you see that? Up to this height. But I want to grow them up to this height. Once they will become this long, then probably I will like to have a dreadlocks. I like these kind of accessories. And this is the hat for my company where I'm working. It's from Move Logistics. You can see the logo. This logo has changed now. This is a very old hat, actually. But I love it. I got my new dresses. I post my WhatsApp status a few days before. Yeah. People are wondering, oh, why I have posted this kind of status. But I love my company, actually, where I love, where I used to work. Yeah. Like, jobs are jobs, actually. If you talk about, like, you know, the overall atmosphere, like, you know, there is a pressure. Pressure is always there, like, you know. And let's go to this grass I was talking about. This is so pretty beautiful. Yeah. And I will take you up to that area. Can you see that? Yeah. Can you see that? My shoes are still, like, you know.
Yeah.
So, what I was telling you, yeah. So my company is good. My bosses are awesome. They give me lots of food. They give me every second day, third day, they have lots of snacks. Yeah. I love to work with them. Pressure are always there. But that's it. Every job has a pressure. Yeah. Let's go there. Maybe we can find some sheep if you are lucky enough. Or maybe some deer. People are breeding deers as well. Yeah. Yeah. Alpaca. These are like, you know, the dairy farming business here. So, what we are discussing about, the more salary you have in your hand, of course, your expenses would be also higher. If we talk about New Zealand, the minimum wage is at present now is $20 per hour. So, let's calculate it in front of you guys, so that you understand what my calculation is all about. So $20 per hour multiplied by, if a normal person works like, you know, 5 days and he has got like, you know, a 10 hours day shift, so he get 50 hours. We will calculate it from 50 hours roughly. People can work more hours as well, depend upon their strength. My contract is for 40 hours with a company. Company wants to give me like, you know, more hours, but I really don't want that. Yeah, I can't put myself like, you know, for whole of my life, like, you know, for earning some money. I really want to focus on myself. I also want to focus on the earnings as well, but personal part is more always get advantage from my side. Like, you know, I always have a priority on personal part. I can't put my head always like, you know, on working and earning some dollars. Yeah, I am very easy guy on personal side. Yeah, I don't care too much about the money. I was earning a good salary in India as well, so probably that was not the case. Yeah, people are complaining about, like, you know, India. I really hate that brother, I'm not getting the desired salary in India. Like, you know, can you just, because of this reason, you want to migrate? He's absolutely a dick. He's absolutely nonsense talking about. If someone will say, like, you know, I'm an arts graduate, I'm not a technical graduate. If you talk about my qualification. Yeah. I'm a simple graduate with some master's in now business administration. And I also done supply chain course from IIT Delhi. But that's not the case. People, I was a simple graduate and I was earning very good amount of salary in India, which was more higher than in New Zealand right now, which I'm getting right now, even after having so much years of experience in New Zealand. If I was in India with the same background, my bosses would give me around, like, say, roughly, in India, my package would be around, like, say, 40 to 50 lakh rupees. In today's scenario, if I work for the same company, which I just left in, like, you know, eight, nine years ago, yeah. If I work with the same company, probably my bosses would like to give me the, like, same normal increment. Note, I'm not expecting a high-fi increment, like, you know, just with the 10% of salary increment. Probably in today's 2021, I would probably enjoying roughly like 40 to 50 lakh rupees annual package. So I don't believe those guys give with their statements, that which is when they say, oh, we are not getting a very good salary in India. So probably they are not on the right track, actually, if they think in that perspective, if they think in that way. So if you talk about, like, you know, in here, that what the expenses are. So let's calculate, like, 50 hours a week, $20 minimum wages, $1,000 per week, multiplied by 52 weeks, $52,000 would be your minimum wages in New Zealand. So, with this package, what would be the living expenses for you? You guys would be. So, I'm living in a house which is like a 3-bedroom house in a farmhouse block. Actually, I living in a rural life, so my living standard are very high. I don't save too much money, yeah, but I want like luxury life. I want like, you know, rural life, which is a little like, you know, someone outskirt the city area. I really like the quiet life actually. So I'm paying around like $550 weekly, monthly rent. About, and top of that, like electricity is separate, Wi-Fi is separate, fuel is separate. Yeah, so you can calculate it. But if you take in the city, say for like 1-bedroom accommodation near to the, like, you know, city center of the city, so probably you will get like $200. A 1-room unit. So one room unit would be, you will get a like 1-bedroom with a living area where you can have some couch and invite your friends, and with like, you know, a kitchen. So that what we call a studio unit actually. So studio unit can roughly get like $200 to $250 a monthly. Yeah, including all the expenses, Wi-Fi and electricity are mostly included when you go for a bachelor accommodation. When you have a family, probably, like, you know, people doesn't give you the, but like if you want to go on a shared accommodation, you can always enjoy that, like electricity and Wi-Fi in the rent, which can be included in the rent. Yeah, that's how, like, you know, New Zealand like living standard works. So for example, if you are living in the same house with your four of your friends, so you take the same 1-bedroom unit and four people, because like house are very big here, so 1-bedroom, like, you know, you can easily accommodate like, you know, 2 persons. And they, I know many of the, like, you know, students, when they just bought, like, you know, a double decker bed actually, where they easily accommodate, like, you know, 1 upon 1, like, you know, just like kids have that kind of setup. Yeah, the same way here, like, you know, double decker beds are also there, easily available. Yeah, so you can go from that side, from the bushes. It's a nice walk, and now drizzling is also there. Like, you can see the water drops. Yeah, that's good. So if we take like $200 or like $250 and you divide it in the four people, so it roughly gives you like $50 or $60 a week expense. Yes. And like you share the rent, and the more you share the rent, cost of living, it will be, does, you can, you know, reduce down your expenses. That's how generally what you, like, you know, most of the Asian do here. Because when you are a bachelor, probably you would like to save some money. Yeah, I wouldn't recommend, like, you know, you just comes on a, like, you know, study visa, or like, you know, you just came on a work visa, you are just alone and you just, you know, enjoy your life, like, you know, with a 2-bedroom house. It's not worth it at all. It's not recommendable at all. Yeah. As I told you, can you read that? So I will read it for you, because maybe it said, like, you know, different version. MTB Racing here, Tuesday evening from 6 p.m. 2nd, 16th and 30th of November and 14th December. So the track will be closed. Yeah. So this is the track. It's a bicycle track. Can you see that? So there is a race is going on these dates. Maybe if I will be available there, maybe we will come. And you will see that race. And as I briefed you, can you see that? Crocodile MTB Park. when we, you know, coming and entering this park, I told you, this is a crocodile. We also called it crocodile park. And can you see a small, like, small, like, water, river there? Not, it's not a river. That's it. This area. Can you see that? This is water, actually. It's a muddy water. Yeah. So how, this is a track. So we go from, we come from here. Now let me close view for this. So we come from here, then we go into this area. We go here, here, here. And where are now we? We are somewhere around here. So this park is very big, like, you know, we can go and up from there up to this area. So this is the top, actually. There is a, like, you know, a highway. This is a highway. We can also come and park our car here, and we can come down from this side by walking. Yeah. You can see this is so beautiful. This is the track, bike track. Yeah, bicycle. Yeah. And that's the exercise ring. Can you see that? That red color. This one. Yeah, this is the exercise ring. So this is the sitting area. He's coming. Yeah, that's so beautiful. We have to give him the way. Turan, hi. So now this is a drizzling going on. Yes, so we can go and stay there for a few minutes. If no, we can't. Sitting in a covered area, maybe we can go back to our car park. Yeah. So we can divide the expenses. Say if you're coming with brother and sister, you can always share the expenses. Hi. Beautiful dog.
My friends, I'm dog sitting.
Probably if we go from that side, we will be have a drizzling is too much. We will be wet. So what we are going to do now? Probably we will wait here. Yeah. By the time, like, you know, drizzling will stop. So, if you coming with a brother and sister, so you can share the expenses. You are coming as a husband and wife with kids, of course you can share the expenses, whether it is New Zealand, whether it is Europe. Yeah, so the question, coming back to the main question, like, you know, which country I would recommend? Probably if you are good at English, probably I would like to go for English speaking countries. If you are not have, like, you know, good English speaking, probably you would like to go either in Southern America, or you have to go to Europe part, basically. So that is what my recommendation is. One thing I must tell you, don't scared of, like, you know, learning new languages. You imagine, so for example, if you are living in India and you are from Northern India, so you speak Hindi. If you go to the Southern India for any kind of job transfer within the company, probably you won't able to survive until you know English, because in Southern India they speak their own language, like, which can be Kannada, which can be Tamil, which can be Telugu, which has their own language, like, you know. So it is pretty hard when we go in southern part and we can't communicate in their local language. People here in South, like, you know, they doesn't understand English well, but some of the English are very, very, very fine, excellent. The same, like, you know, in Northern India, all the people doesn't speak English. They speak their local language. So coming back to the same struggle you find in your home country, the same struggle you will find in overseas as well. If you are finding yourself hard to learn new language, probably you won't like to migrate anywhere. Because at the end of the day, if you can't communicate, so probably you won't get a job. The answer is very simple. My recommendation would be learn the moderate English. If you can't learn advanced English, if you really want to come outside the and migrate in overseas, my strongly recommendation would be the first language you should learn English. A moderate one, not the basic one. With basic, you can't get a job. You can get a job, but probably you won't survive. Because people, like most of the customer service job, most of like, you know, a day-to-day communication, when you talk to your neighbors, subordinates, or seniors or juniors, they speak their either their own language or they speak in English. If you can't able to communicate with them, probably it is very difficult to survive. You can't use their accent, like, you know, they use slang words. The same way, like, you know, if someone, like, you know, from southern India or I'm from eastern side, he comes to Delhi, we all being racist with him, with that fellow. Yeah. I find the same experience when I was in India. So there were people, like, you know, we making used to, like, you know, making fun of them. But that's, like, you know, jokes apart, like, you know, I never been personalized, like, you know, to never hurt anyone, like, you know, on that side. But, like, you know, when we take our, like, you know, other colleagues, they used to make fun of them, who is, like, you know, not from their hometown actually. Yeah. So same thing apply here as well. If you don't able to communicate, or, like, you know, if you mispronounce any word or it doesn't pronounce correctly, so they doesn't learn your accent, they doesn't understand your language, so you it will be difficult. They will avoid your communication, like, and they will avoid contacting you. And you will be isolated. You will feel like an isolated person. That's my actual experience about this overseas. I can easily communicate in English, so you can see that, like, you know, my English is not pretty good, but still how, like, and I can manage the show. Yeah, somehow I will crack, like, you know, 6.5 or 7 band easily. Yeah, in the IELTS examination, I done it before. But still, if you ask about my experience, like, you know, despite, like, you know, I communicate this, like, you know, make this video for 1 hour, like, you know, long, only in English, so you can understand my English is pretty moderate. I can't call myself as an excellent communicator. I can't be called myself as an expert speaking English, as an expert English speaker. But of course, like, you know, I can match the requirement. If they talk about, like, you know, residency or citizenship requirement, when they come back to, like, you know, IELTS examination, probably I will crack that. Yeah. Because I keeps on practicing every day. I can make this video in Hindi as well, in local language, because most of my followers are basically from my Asian countries, but 20-30% people are from, like, you know, different nationalities specifically, because I travel a lot around the world. So some of our followers are, like, you know, from Southern America, and 5% or 10% are from, like, you know, Europe countries. Some of them are from Gulf countries as well. Yeah. But most of them are the Southern America and African countries. So they don't understand, like, Hindi. So people asking me, oh, your English is like, you know, very, very high. So guys, my English is not very high. It is just a moderate, like, you know, you can say. I'm not an expert English speaker. I don't call myself. Yeah. You can imagine, like, even at moderate level English, like, you know, I find it difficult. So probably, like, you know, who doesn't speak English, so probably it will be very difficult for them to survive here. Getting a job, communication, getting food, everything, like, you know, groceries, everything, like, you know, everyone speaks English only in English-speaking countries. People generally think, like, you know, oh, there are lots of Indian, like, you know, if we talk about Germany, yeah, you will find a plenty of Indians there. Let give me another example. In New Zealand, there is one place called, like, Auckland. I was in Auckland in 2015. I lived there, like, for 1 year, whole year. So there is one place called, like, Papatoetoe, Mankau. So these are the areas which is just like a series of Indians are there. All the house, like, you know, belongs to Indians only. Oh, every street, every grocery store, every shopping complex, or like, you know, offices, everywhere Indians are there. It is overcrowded. If you go to like Delhi, because I belong to Delhi, so if you go to Delhi, like Rajouri Garden or like, you know, Tilak Nagar, Pahadgarh, you will find like lot of turban guys there, like, you know. The same way, like, you know, you will find more than like, you know, 100,000 Indians only in that location. So you won't miss India if you go and live there. Probably, like, you know, you can easily survive there. You can easily get job there. But right now I'm living from last, like, you know, almost 8-9 years in Christchurch. So Christchurch is like, you know, you might get like Indians there, but not too much. Yeah, there are only limited Indians here. So probably if you go and hang out with them, like, you know, but there are Southern Indian as well. So Southern Indian, they don't speak Hindi. You'll find the same language problem with them. If you don't know English, so probably you won't be able to communicate with your Indian brothers and sisters. Yeah. So that's the hard part of the story. People think, oh, I will learn there, like, you know, when I will go to the English speaking country, then I will improve my English there, when I will day to day communicate with them. Yeah, that's how they think. Because they think they will find the Indian crowd there, and this way, like, you know, they can learn and, like, you know, communicating in English. Yeah, but that could be one case. But it's up to you guys. I mean to say, I won't comment it too much about this part. Yeah. So what my idea is, like, you know, every country is beautiful. There are some, like, you know, girls also calling me back, like, you know, they want to come alone outside India. They feel very scary. I got, like, you know, 1 month before, there were, like, you know, 2-3 girls who are from the same group, actually. But later I figure it out, like, you know, I don't know why they just, you know, feel very scary. Even while talking to over the phone, they feel scary, like, you know, they don't want to, you know, show their identity. Yeah, but somehow, like, you know, when they communicate with me, like, you know, they gain my trust. Then I come to know, like, you know, like, all those 4-5 girls are from the same group. I don't know, like, you know, whether they are coming together or where they coming alone. But, like, you know, they feel scary. Oh, how they are going to survive, like, when no family members are there. Yeah. So it would be difficult, like, you know, you live in your home country in a different style, like, you know. One girl was from, like, you know, Allahabad, basically. She was from a nursing background. So she was communicating with me. She was not very confident. Yes. So, but I tell him clearly, like, you know, if you talk about, like, in India, Allahabad, like, you know, when you go for a nightlife, probably you can't go and hang around in the city, which is not pretty safe for women, specifically when you go and, like, you know, walk around in a, like, you know, and lonely street. It's not safe at all. But in overseas, like, you know, I have been to more than 30 countries, so probably it's not been scared. You will feel 100% secure. Yeah, because people are very organized. There are crimes, but, like, you know, not too much. Maybe like 1% cases, like, you know, like, crime is everywhere. Like, you cannot be, you know, cannot find a single country where which is like crime-free country. We really cannot call any country. But if you are going for a lonely street, like, you know, and hang out with your friends, probably that's not a safe area. Yeah, the same way. But most of the countries are organized. They are, like, you know, now there is only little visiting, but it's not stopped. It has stopped now. I really enjoy walking here. Yeah, it's so beautiful. Yeah. If the drizzling was not here, like, people were doing camping here. Let me take you from this side. You can still see, like, even in drizzling, there are people around the park, like, you know, with their dogs. There is another lady is coming. Yeah, with the dog. So what I was telling you, it's safe everywhere. So don't feel panic. Don't feel insecure. Yeah, it's 100% safe. Because people are really organized, as I told you. They are honest. Yeah. They communicate well, like, you know, they are very helpful. Yeah. They are very friendly. Yeah, I've been to Southern America, I've been to Europe, I've been to Switzerland, France, Czech Republic, Austria. I've never been to UK, but I've been to Germany. Yeah, Germany, Hungary, Budapest. Then Italy, I was there. Yeah. Europe is beautiful, but most of my time, like, you know, as I've been based in New Zealand, so I like to be here, actually. Yeah. The life in New Zealand, you can call, like, you know, the walking culture and the personal life, like, you know, it's not mixing together. People really enjoy their personal life. When they are at the office, at the job, they really walk very hard. Yeah. No one can mug around here and there, like, you know. But when you talk about, like, you know, on the person side, yeah, people really enjoy their, like, you know, on the weekend. They just throw whatever they earn in the whole week, they just throw that money to the parties. They are really having lots of fun in the weekend, like, you know, by enjoying the parties here. Yeah, that's the lifestyle of this country, actually. Yeah, people really go for outdoor activities. People do a lot of activities here. Yeah, yeah. They've been grown and brought up like that only. People are really independent. Like, kids are really independent when they just become, like, you know, high school graduate. Yeah. So graduate doesn't mean you are a degree holder. So they also call, like, you know, high school graduate as well, like, you know, when they are in school. That's, like, you know, the local, how they call themselves. Yeah. So what topic we have discussed? New Zealand lifestyle. I told you about, like, you know, I live in a farmhouse. If I get a chance, like, you know, when I will go home, I will just give you a small walk around my home as well. Then you guys will be able to know where I'm living, like, you know, what kind of quality life I'm enjoying here. Yeah. So we have 3 cars in our house, of course, like, you know, I'm a fond of very big cars. I just sold my Skyline like month before. Yeah, that was a sports model. The one I'm driving right now is also a, like, you know, it's not, we can call 100% sport, but it's a hybrid car where I just come. But I have 2 small car as well. Yeah, I just keep rotating my cars, vehicles. I have a scooter as well. Yeah, a 50cc moped. You can solve, but it looks like a scooter, but actually it is a moped. See, this is so beautiful. This is just like a, what you call, a walkway, a shelter way, maybe. It's a covered area, actually. Covered with, like, you know, wooden things. So can you see that? This is a wooden net, and on top of that, like, you know, you might get a, Hindi mein kya bola, I don't know, remember actually, English. So this is called Kurashiki Garden. Big and historical area, Kurashiki. Yeah. So we can have a walk toward this side. We have made this video for 1 hour, but people really want to talk to me, actually. I don't know why. They feel good. I'll talk to them. So this is a, like, open area. So people are usually come on the weekend if this weather was clear. Yeah. They really enjoy here to be as an outdoor activity. They come with their family, with their kids, and just play around, having tents, barbecue, yeah, in this park. But one has to have a barbecue, he has to clean himself. Yeah, he has to clean his shit. That's the thumb rule. You really can't leave your shit here and there and just walk around or just walk away. people really don't want to do that for you. These Japanese trees, popular in Israel, ornamental are also. So this we call a Japanese tree actually. So you can see that. Let me show you. Let me see that. This flower. This is so beautiful. You can't zoom that actually. Yeah. Hello. The path is very big enough. We couldn't go because of the cloudy weather or this drizzling to the top, but maybe one day I came here before as well, but if I get a chance then I'll bring you guys here again and we'll make another video and I will take you to the top. Yeah. So now I'm going back to my car. Yes, I will take you there and from there we will go back to home. Or maybe we can have a look here as well before we finish. Yeah. Maybe I will cover up some 1 or 2 minutes in my home so that you guys should know. So that was the sliding area where I show you from the top. Can you see that? This side, yeah. So it's really not like a real landslide, I think. But you can go and walk there. Can you see that? This grass. This is a walkway path. So it's a completely safe area. This is not a landsliding. This one. Yeah. Likewise, we have it in a dog park. Yeah. So we can go there. Around that mountains and like you know we can have a walk around towards that side. Shall I show you my bandanas? These are my this handband, wristband. Yeah. So when I bought it from Aloha, the Aloha is from Hawaii in America. The another like you know the turtle was from somewhere in Europe. I forgot that. I think Poland. I think yeah. And this one the this one this this multicolor one. This is again I got it from Europe. Yeah. This. Locket, I got it from Chile. Chile is beautiful. People are awesome there. Yeah. So that's it. I will stop my video here. And once I will reach my home, then I will cover up my rest of the video. Yeah. So guys, this is my house. So you can see. We live in this area, this a big house. Can you see that? Yeah. So I will take you a small look about. I live in a 10-acre farmhouse. So this is our sheep. Can you see that? Yeah. So we have around like 50 sheep here. This is another paddock. In this grass, this shed, there is another side. It's very big property. It won't come. You can scare it. Shall I show you the baby lamb?